Welcome back. Well, federal authorities are saying there's a credible threat to our nation this weekend on the anniversary of 9/11, possibly involving car bombs in New York or Washington, D.C. And it just continues to remind us that though we haven't seen another major attack since 9/11, the threat of terrorism is always with us. And especially now, we need to be grateful for those who have worked so hard to keep us safe since 9/11. One of the men who deserves an enormous amount of credit for that is former U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft. He was charged with transforming the U.S. Department of Justice after 9/11, moving it into attack prevention mode, and that led to the capture of terrorists and disruption of terror plots all across the world. He left office in 2005. He wrote a great book called Never Again about his experience. He currently heads up the Ashcroft Group, LLC, and it is an absolute honor to have him with us today as we talk about 9/11 and also his reflections on it, especially as a Christian. Attorney General Ashcroft, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. I'm glad to be with you.
Well, we are hearing these reports today about this renewed threat of a 9/11 anniversary attack. I'm curious, when you were Attorney General, were the 9/11 anniversaries regarded as more dangerous times for attacks than other days of the year?
I think it is consistent with what we know about the terrorist movement, that they do high-profile things. They want to do things that get public attention and worldwide attention. They like to do things that get a lot of press attention because terror obviously requires an awareness by people that they are at risk. So it is consistent with the way terrorists generally operate, that they try to do things in ways that would be the most flamboyant and the most attention-getting. And obviously, at a time to be able to say when we are celebrating our safety that they would penetrate the safety and disrupt it would be something attractive to terrorists.
Yes, well, many people may not realize that you were in the skies yourself on 9/11. Your book, Never Again, goes through, chronicles what you went through. Great book that I really enjoyed reading.
Thank you.
Yes, now you were heading to the Midwest, and what I find really fascinating is even getting back to Washington at that time was a risky proposition for you. What do you reflect back on? What was that experience like trying to get back to Washington at such a momentous time?
Well, when I learned about the attacks on the Twin Towers and the Pentagon, I was in the air over Michigan, and I said to the pilot, turn the plane around, we'll go back to Washington. It turns out we didn't have enough fuel to get back to Washington, so we descended across Lake Michigan, landed in Milwaukee. The SWAT teams surrounded the plane, and we refueled, and I ordered the plane back into the sky. But one of the first objectives on 9/11 was to, quote, clear the air, was to get planes out of the sky to try and ascertain whether we had another wave of attacks, whether there would be other planes. And so as we approached the Washington area, we were not allowed to enter the Washington airspace, even in our government airplane, and even with under my direction as Attorney General, until a fighter escort. And we were escorted to land at the Reagan National Airport, and we did. And I guess I was one of the last, if not the last, plane to land there that afternoon. So our first objective was to clear the skies, to try and anticipate or avert any other attack that might be coming as a result of a plane. And we had planes coming across the Atlantic and the Pacific. So there were that was an early objective and a first responsibility.
Yes, it was a huge undertaking to ground the American airlines all around the world. As you mentioned, the airspace was closed eventually. How much information did you actually have about terrorism initially, when you were still in the airplane heading back to Washington? Did you think it was Al-Qaeda, the work of Al-Qaeda?
I wasn't in a position to know exactly at that time how this had happened. When we got back to Washington and we began to assemble the information, it wasn't long until we had the passenger lists and we had an understanding of the common factors that would bind together the individuals who had plotted. There was some information that came, though, as a result of telephone calls made by individuals who were on the plane at the time, on the planes, particularly the plane going into the Pentagon. Ted Olson, who was the Solicitor General of the United States, he's the person who argued the U.S. position in the Supreme Court of the United States and is a high-ranking Justice Department official. His wife was on the plane, and she made several calls. So while the plane was being directed back into the Pentagon. So we had some information that came as a result of calls that were made by people on the airplanes that began to signal to us, some of the circumstances, and we began to piece together an understanding of who was responsible.
Well, we need to go to a break. I'm speaking with former U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft about 9/11. We'll be right back. President George W. Bush, at the time of 9/11, gave a directive to U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft, never again, never let this happen again. And that was the directive followed by the former U.S. Attorney General. He wrote a book about it called Never Again. He now is heading up the Ashcroft Group, LLC, but we are reflecting about 9/11, his experience, and his thoughts as a Christian as well. After 9/11, General Ashcroft, you had so much to do to reorient the Department of Justice from prosecution to prevention, and you had all sorts of strategies. You had to deal with the wall problem between law enforcement and intelligence. You used the spit on the sidewalk strategy, as you called it. And then we saw the implementation of legislation like the USA Patriot Act. How do you reflect back now, 10 years later, on the decisions that were made and the successes that we ended up having from your efforts to keep America safe?
Well, our biggest concern was to avert any second wave of attacks or additional attacks. And it's one thing to be the subject of a surprise attack and the world understand that the United States might not have been focused on that. But if we were the subject of a series of attacks, a second wave or a third wave of attacks, and it began to look as if we had an incapacity to defend ourselves, that would have been a serious matter, not only to those of us in the United States, but it would have signaled to the world that the primary proponent of freedom in the world was incapable of resisting against those individuals who fought against freedom. And I identify the terrorist movement as a movement that opposes freedom, because if it could achieve what it wanted in a free way by getting people to endorse it, it would. But it's decided that it can't convince people in the marketplace of ideas that its way is best, so it seeks to impose what it believes rather than to inspire what it believes. So my view is that we simply had to do what was necessary to establish the credible capacity of our country to defend itself, and we were very concerned about subsequent attacks, and I thank God and I thank the American people that as working together, people were vigilant, and the Justice Department, the FBI, the U.S. Marshals, the federal prosecutors, and other intelligence agencies and capacities were successful and have been over the last decade.
Exactly right. I know that you had such a huge responsibility on your shoulders at the time there as U.S. Attorney General, but you're also a Christian. And I'm wondering, have you ever spent much time reflecting on the theological angle of what happened on 9/11? I mean, the fact that fundamentally it was the jihadists' idea of God and who they thought God was that drove them to commit this horrible attack on America?
Well, it's undeniable that these individuals were religious zealots, and that they felt that that they were somehow to be rewarded eternally for being involved in these heinous acts of violence, and that kind of perversion is most troubling, and there's not a lot that we can do to affect how zealots of that kind operate in various remote locations of the world, but we need to be aware of them, and we need to guard against them in every respect.
Well, that's true, and of course your job was to respond from a legal perspective and a political perspective to terrorism. It wasn't so much to address the ideology, and yet the ideology is what drove them. The power of prayer, I know, was very important for you and has been, you know, throughout your life as a Christian. How did you engage in prayer at that time, you know, going through all you went through to try to shoulder the responsibility of keeping America safe?
You know, when I left the Justice Department, I told the president that we had won the war on terror, and we had. We'd won it in every day after 9/11, and you have to win it every day. It's not something that can be won once and for all. But I expressed my sense that we needed to be thankful to the Creator for helping us sustain our safety in the interval that we spent in defense. I was reminded of the Bible verse that says, and I think it's either Proverbs or Psalms, probably the Psalms, it says, except the Lord guards a city, the watchman watches in vain.
Right.
And so from me and my personal perspective, I continue to pray for the safety of America and the security of the freedoms we enjoy here. And I believe that we need to work. If there are ever a time when the admonition to watch and pray, sometimes those seem to be inconsistent. Well, I think we need to watch and pray. I like the old saying that row as if there is no God and pray as if there are no oars.
That's great.
So we have to do everything we can, but we ask God to help us.
I completely agree. That's very well said. When Osama bin Laden was killed by our SEALs earlier this year, you mentioned in the book, you know, when we were able to kill al-Zarqawi, you had mentioned in your book, we knew there would be another one to replace him. Did you have the same sense when you heard about the killing of bin Laden that this was a victory of sorts, but yet we couldn't completely let our guard down?
Yeah, absolutely. I couldn't describe it more accurately myself, Janet. We are not going to ever win this war to the extent that we can ignore the potential of being attacked again. As soon as you ignore the potential of terrorist activity, you devalue your defense, and that increases the risk of being hit. And yet we can be grateful for the victories we've achieved. And I'm grateful for the kind of work that was done in terms of harvesting information and intelligence that provided a basis for this administration to find and to do away with Osama bin Laden. I think that that reflects the value of long-term commitments to defending the country and providing the kind of resources that are necessary to be successful in defeating the terrorists one at a time. And obviously, evil does not cease to exist because you end the life of a great evildoer. Others tend to fill in those settings and have since the beginning of time.
No doubt about it. Former U.S. Attorney General John Ashcroft is with us. And when we come back, his thoughts on the future, the greatest threat that we face as a nation now from terrorists. We'll be back right after this.